Okay, let's start. So today we're doing game theory. So who knows what's happening here, what this story is? Yeah. Exactly. Right, so it's an alternative mating strategy. One strategy in cuttlefish is like, look at me, I'm big and beautiful. The other strategy is, look at me, I'm smart. And so on this side, he looks like a female to other males. There's a male here. And the other side looks like a male to this female. And so even though he's smaller than other males, he can sort of not be attacked by them because he appears to be a female to them. And then he can mate with females that are willing. Right? And so this strategy of like mating, there's two alternate strategies males can adopt. One is sort of this, you know, crypsis, and one is being a dominant male. So depending on their state status, they can do the different approaches. Okay, we're talking about this sort of thing today in game theory, right? Where you know choosing your strategy based on the strategies of other players in the system. Okay, first a few clicker questions just to make sure keeping up with things. Oh, 41. Do you guys need to track like right answers over time? If the first people answer right and after that sort of becomes random, or you will think more, do better, so long, you know. In this case, we're definitely the latter, the former.
Okay.
Yes.
On this. Always. Do you ask a question?
Yes.
Can I give something away?
That's okay.
Okay. When you say always, you mean that it would continue? Like, they would continue to exist?
I mean that every time this trait appears, it has a higher extinction rate than speciation rate. Yeah.
Or maybe not.
Things with this.
It
has some other trait, whatever. Yeah.
But then it shows up and
dies. I'm just focusing on this trait.
Okay.
Yep. No one has changed his answer at all. So he didn't mess up the class. All right. Any other questions? Okay. So, survey says. So, what should be the right answer?
Yes.
Right, hand raised. Yes. Yes. Why?
I was thinking, okay, it's just one trait, and we had your little tree, the branch off, and let's say we have two. So we just have two system groups. The one, the trait shows up, and then the extinction rate, it dies. But then the other one keeps going, let's say it branches again, but then the trait shows up again, and it dies again. So it can happen over and over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
And so it can always be
more. Okay. What's an argument for the no? For yes being the right answer. Or yeah, the other answer. Okay, so you're saying it's detrimental, so one thing is that the causes of extinction may not be the causes that lead to fitness in the population, right? So asexuality, right, could lead to higher extinction rate, but short-term could be advantageous. Yeah. So the correct answer is B. Okay. Have a chance to redeem yourselves now. Okay, 1 minute. Hey, Syndicate. Okay, why is that?
Syndicates are a subgroup of Chordata. Layer 3 names, so it's like one of the three names, and they're like,
So that's a one. Right. So Syndicates are chordates. Right. It's also the taxon of the day for today. Right.
But they're within Chordata. Salamanders are here, so are you, so are tunicates. Okay? Neftozozel are actually echinoderms.
Alright, any questions about this? Okay. So, move on. Alright, so let's give you a hypothetical example. Okay, for game theory now. Alright. So you and your acquaintance are arrested for a crime you committed together. Okay, you committed the crime. Okay, it's maybe harder for some of you to believe than others, but okay. unless of you one of the, at least one of you testifies, there is enough evidence to convict either of you of the main crime. But you each get a month on a secondary charge, right? So you don't get charged for breaking and entering, but you get charged for trespassing or something. Okay. If one of you provides evidence, the snitch goes free, and the other one goes to jail for a year. Okay. If both of you provide evidence, you go to jail for 3 months. Okay? Regardless of whatever happens, you're never going to interact with this person again. Right? Too risky. Okay. So what do you do? Yes, acquaintance. Yeah.
I think if you average it out...
Well, first think, like, talk to each other and think about it.
So if the question is, what do you
I was actually making this a thing where you got like clicker points for it, so you could actually compete. There might be ethical things where like you know students gamble in class or you know. Yeah, even so, human subjects are funny things. All right, 1 minute. All right, so if you would snitch, raise your hand. Everyone look around at the snitches, okay? All right, so those who would not snitch, why wouldn't you? Unspoken code. Okay. What else?
Some rando I met at a party and we did something stupid, I'd snitch on him. But if it was like my best friend and I knew he wouldn't snitch on me, then I wouldn't say anything.
Okay, because you know how the person's going to act then. You have
yeah.
some information. Okay. And if everyone keeps their code, same thing. You have information. Okay. What else?
Just the point. Some people get like the interrogation. But even if you know, I would.
Yeah, people track.
Yeah, people track. You also consider. Well, I consider the fact that if I did snitch,
uh-huh.
it could also be found out that I snitched in that bad
situation. Oh, that's true. That's true if you're both, yeah.
So
that
that's a good point.
Yeah. Yes. That's a good point. So like, so these setups always assume that like, you know, I have, you know, 1 unit of penalty is better than 3 units of penalty. Right. But a month in jail is a snitch. Is probably, you know, 3 months in jail is a snitch is probably worse than, right. So these don't assume equal penalties.
That's
interesting. Yeah.
Okay.
Who would, yeah. Well, that person may have. You don't know that going in. Oh, right. Okay. Let's move on. So, to use this in canonical game theory, if you were someone like in economics or in evolutionary biology, what you would do is you would tally up the costs and figure out which strategy gives you the most fitness, given what the other partner can play. And this is the essence of game theory. Right? So, let's imagine my partner snitches. Right? What's the best strategy there? Something that counts the cost correctly. What? Right, so 3 versus 0, right? And again, maybe we want to change the cost function. Maybe this isn't, you know, if I'm on the outside and snitched, maybe it's a little bit on 0 cost. If you come to cost appropriately, you get the right answer, right, what you should do. But if your partner lies, what's the best answer? What gives you the cost? Snitching. 0 cost versus 1 cost. This is a canonical example known as the prisoner's dilemma, right? And it's, you have a situation set up where you don't know what your opponent's going to do. It sounds like, oh, what should I do? What to do? We just write a cost matrix. You know, you can find out, oh, it's always better if I snitch, right? And if you have a code you don't want to violate, you can put in, you know, 3 plus code violation, 0 plus code violation. Put the cost in some way and say, okay, is this, you know, is 12 versus 3 plus code violation worse or better, right? Once you can tally the costs, you can put it inside the same matrix. Okay? And that's the essence of game theory. Okay? Now for evolution, we think about an evolutionary stable strategy, right? The strategy is stable under natural selection. So if I have a situation where everyone's snitching, right? If I then invent lying, right? What happens? You win, right? So then that strategy invades, right? What if everyone's already snitching? Everyone's always lying. Snitching invades. And so, you know, when they have the situation of everyone snitching, then the stable strategy, the one that keeps, you know, if you have a new individual that presents a new strategy, doesn't do as well as the ones already doing the strategy, is the lie. Right? And so, you're thinking about things competing in nature, you know, they're doing some sort of calculation like this. It might not be calculation by, like, thinking about a table, right? Is that those that have this strategy have more offspring than those that don't. So evolution tunes it. It's also used in economics and things like that. Okay.
Six hyenas.
So here we see, you know, different contexts of nature. Right? So here are crocodiles all feeding from one carcass, right? Here we see some eagles fighting. Here we see infinity lions fighting those. And see here we see two snakes wrestling. Right? They wrestle. Here, look at that. Right? And so these eagles are competing, and so what they do is lock talons and then sort of play chicken. They spin down, and he who lets go first loses. Right? What?
Thanks, chicken.
Yeah. They're called chicken knots, right? You know, the snakes, I mean, they could bite each other, but they're not. They're in sort of combat, control combat. Right? Here we see lions and hyenas fighting over carcass. They're not killing each other. You know, they're posturing and snarling and things like that. They're actually going to have to kill one another. And the lions eventually back off. Right? Here, lions and crocs fighting or something. You know, they're not fighting to the death over this. Yeah?
Have you seen the German
enemies? No. You should check that out. It's all around. Okay.
It's a national geographic.
It's pretty old now. Okay. Yeah, so this is long conflict, and they don't, you know, so, why don't they, you know, in a species, you know, they're fighting over mating opportunities in these cases, right? Why don't they fight to the death? Right? Because sterility is the same as death, basically. We have no offspring, and the genes aren't passed on. Tough. So why don't things fight to the death?
Because you have a chance to maybe next year.
Right, so maybe the best strategy is to wait, and they'll do better next year. Why else? Mm-hmm. All right, so you might win, but you might die. And so that doesn't do you much good. Yep. Well, they're trying to get it back, but they're not, like, attacking the lion. Yeah. Yeah. All right, so why not, you know, fight more? Right. And so one thing people often bring up here is, you know, the good of the species, right? Right. We don't have this. We have this ritual combat because of the good of the species. You can't have all the males limping around one year, right? Well, what do you know about that? No, right? You know, you guys can go take care of the good of the species. All people look out for me, right? Long term, I'm going to do better than you are, right? So there's minor exceptions which we'll get into, but in general, you know, the good of the species doesn't argue, doesn't work in nature. Right? It's all about individual incentives. Right? So, then why do things, you know, not fight to the death over things? And so Maynard Smith and Dew Price actually developed a computer model for this back in 1973. I guess there were computers then. and so then you're thinking about why things can choose to fight and why, you know, things that have lethal venom might not use it in a fight. Sort of thing. Okay? And they developed a game, and that's okay. There's three kinds of moves you can do. Right? You can push, right, or punch, and do a traditional move, right? It's like, if we're doing this ritual combat, we're getting damage, it's not hurting us that much. Right? It's a dangerous move, where it can, you know, stab or something, right? Whereas it's a lethal move, okay? or is it a retreat move, right? Roll away, run away or roll over, something like that, right? And so we can then think about different strategies we can use with our mixtures that we move, right? We have a coward, we always retreat. Is that going to win any contests? No, right? It's something that always goes conventional. It's something that always just moves its opponent. Like, hi, what are you doing? right? And so you can see which strategy is going to pay off. And like everything else in game theory, put in a set of costs, right? So if you win, plus 60. Retreat, you get 0. Since you defend against dangerous attack, right, someone tries to stab you with a knife and you defend, still get, you know, nicked. Right? Unsuccessfully defend. -100. Game over. and then setting winner quickly might have a benefit too. If we're sitting there going punch, 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 we're not eating, we're not getting other meeting opportunities, there's a cost to continuing the game. So that's what's the model too. And so, if the opponent is sort of programmed to do this series of moves, punch, 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 stab, punch, stab, punch, punch, stab, right? Yeah, like Rock, Paper, Scissors almost. And which, and so, the mouse strategy is you keep punching, that's when it pulls a knife, you retreat. Okay? It's a little bit of the mice strategy, but hey. There's the hawk strategy, all stabbing all the time. There's a bully strategy. Start off aggressive. If someone matches you, you stand down a little bit. You go back aggressive. If somebody matches you again, you go aggressive again, you retreat. Like grade school, you know. Retaliator. So you always do what your opponent does. Your opponent throws a fish, throw a fist. Opponent throws a knife, throw a knife. And finally, a strategy known as Probe Retaliator, right, where you are escalating, and then if your opponent escalates and you stand down a little bit, you're escalating again. Okay, so just respond to the opponent that way. And so, create this series of strategies. I think you can figure out the cost benefits of each strategy, right, given this opponent. What you can also do with a computer is you can play them against each other. And so once I have it programmed, I can then have the computer say, okay, I want to have this mouse fight this mouse. And they can sit there and trade punches all day. Right? And then I can try play having a mouse fight a hawk. You know, the hawk mouse runs away right away. Okay? So I'll outside a little bit. But if we do these strategies, this is what we get out. Okay? Where here's the net benefit. We have, you know, a mouse fighting a mouse that gets 29. Mouse fighting a hawk gets 19.5. Right? Retaliator fighting a hawk, they get 22.3. Okay. And so you can see if you're a hawk, right? Hawk versus hawk. Hawk versus mouse goes really well. Hawk versus hawk goes really poorly. I'm going to figure out, you know, what strategy is best across all opposing strategies, right? And so Hawk, you know, is a little bit stone by these others, right? But Mouse does okay against all, right? And Bully does okay against all, okay? I'm going to figure out which strategy is, you know, optimal, okay? Any questions about that? You can also think about something called spite, right? So why do some organisms, you know, why will they attack other organisms, right? You know, potentially costly to them, okay? And in human societies, one thought is, you know, one reason we have society is because, you know, if I go over and slap you, right, who's going to bother calling the police on me, right? That takes time for you. You just drain your battery. Why bother, right? Well, you know, it's a minor cost, be sure, but I mean, that sort of thing costs you something and doesn't help you directly. So that's what we call spite, right? So it's sort of the opposite end of altruism, right? Why would you do something to help someone else? Why are you doing to hurt someone else? Why are you going to hurt anybody by ratting me out to the police, right? and so, you know, why is this guy bothering to guard this guy here? Okay, and so again, we can create models for this. So here we have the fitness of punishers in society, right? And this is those who never punish, okay? And we can create a strategy where you only punish if you have enough people with you who also are punishers, right? If we all call, if we all get up and protect this person, maybe we'll do that strategy, otherwise no, right? And so you can see at what point this strategy of being spiteful or punishing crosses the line of zero. Why is that important? Right, so when it crosses that line, the fitness is higher for those who punish. Right. And so you can find out what conditions are required for having this sort of strategy appear. Okay. Again, with these simple models. So you can say, okay, maybe human society, once you have enough people who have this trait, it becomes common. Okay. We can also come up with, when we talk about Wolbachia, right? The only Wolbachia population, you know, you tend to lower fitness. Once you have enough Wolbachia population, if you don't have Wolbachia, you have fewer offspring on average. Okay, so this is minimum invasion threshold that once you get over that line, then it sweeps through fixation. Okay. Any questions about that? Okay. So. So what's this guy doing? Shouting at things. What's he shouting at? When have you seen a squirrel do this? Yeah. An enemy, right? It's like, look, a dangerous predator. Hey, hey you, I'm over here, I'm over here, I'm over here. It's not typically the response to a dangerous predator, right? Is a cat scared of the squirrel doing this?
Right.
It's probably a cat or something that's, you know, potentially, you know, you if you look threatening. It's something the squirrel is scared of. The squirrel climbs up a tree and starts shouting. Right. So why is it doing this? Is it threatening? Don't make him down there and bite you?
Is he alerting other squirrels?
So he'd be alerting other squirrels. Why would he do that?
Because that would be sort of a group fitness sort of thing.
Mm-hmm. Right, if the other squirrels are relatives, then by alerting the squirrels, he's helping his relatives survive. Yep. Yeah. Is it silence afraid, right? Why is it so? I mean, some things are involuntary, right? Where, I'd love to fly, but I can't. I just don't have the trait to fly, right? Sounds, vocalizations like this often aren't involuntary, right? So, you know, if there's enough variation in the population, if squirrels were, you know, harmed by doing this, this would be swept out. So, probably not in that case.
Might be telling the cat, hey, I see
you,
so you
can't
get surprised on me.
Mm-hmm. Right, might be talking to the cat. Why would that be
advantageous? He's telling the cat that you shouldn't put forth the effort because I already know that you are.
Mm-hmm. Right. And so, for the squirrel, it's actually communicating with the cat. Right. And so, why should the cat listen? Right, cat lazy. So it's efficient, right? So if it's okay. The game's up on this one, and they can try to hunt something else. And the squirrel can get back to foraging faster, the cat can go get food faster. And so it's advantageous for them both to have the signal and to listen to the signal. Right? Even though, you know, the cat would love to kill the squirrel, you know, given that's not going to happen today, may as well move on to better luck, better prey. Right? Wild squirrels just walk around all the time going, and it seems like it's great. All the cats are just like, oh, wow, I've been caught again, okay. And never attack a squirrel. Mm-hmm. Right. So only works if it's an honest signal, an honest enough signal. Right? And it's just, you know, the squirrel does it all the time, and all it would be is like, squirrel is here signal. Right? Instead of an alarm signal. And then it would be selected against because squirrels would mean it would be dead. Right? and so that's sort of how honest signaling is maintained in nature. Right? You have this sort of, you know, if you start lying, it becomes less effective, right? So a lot of times, signaling is based on things that are either costly to produce or that have some way of, you know, if you start lying about it, it can be detected and found out. Any questions about that? Okay. Here he's an antelope, right? And they're running as fast as they can, and then they do this thing. Right? This is saying, look how happy I am to be chased by a lion. It caught real defense. Morning, I know, take food. Well, no, now it's done. So, this is called stalking. It's a lot of prey animals do this sort of behavior where they're running and they do something like crazy, like, look at me! As they run, right? like something on like X Games or something, right? Why am I video doing this? Exactly. Not only can I outrun you, can I outrun you doing backflips, sort of thing. So don't even bother today. Right? And so this has to be another way of signaling between predators and prey. Okay. So the question's about game theory. Where else might we see it in nature? What else could you use if you apply game theory? What about between herbivores and plants? So I could put up, you know, secondary compounds to make myself unpalatable, right? But it has a cost to growth. But, you know, could be putting that energy to making things grow. And so, you know, at what point is it more advantageous to produce more toxic chemicals than to not, right? Given that I know that, you know, there are other plants in my population that might be producing more or fewer, right? They want to be less tasty than Larry, right? And maybe have fewer herbivores than Larry. Yeah. How so?
Because it's been energy to develop the food, and depending on whether or not it would be taken far enough away for your offspring to develop, it may or may not be more effective just to develop the food and body around the food.
Yeah, so you think about, you know, what can we dispersal, and I could have a mixture of traits that I could make food or not make food. Put energy into fruit, put energy into vegetative growth. Which do I do? Right? Timing of fruiting can matter too. So if I want to have my fruit disperse and have other plants in the area that are also producing fruits, is it better if I have the same strategy with them and produce fruits at the same time? Or is it better to offset it and so that when I produce fruit, I'm the only game in town? Yeah. Good. It's actually thought that one reason for fall foliage colors is as a signal to potential herbivores that, you know, if I can produce these bright yellows and green, bright yellows and reds, they're going to have lots of toxic compounds in them, so it needs to stay away. Whereas those that can't produce that color, just sort of simply brown, maybe weaker, easier to attack, so go kill them instead. That's still pretty controversial, but sort of an interesting idea to think about. Other ways where game theory could be important.
Maybe like within conflicts, like when, I guess it's the same thing, like when they continue to escalate, like some elk will like do little sidewalks and then they'll roar each other and then they'll start to like platform.
Right. Yep. So during conflict, you know, when order can be or makes, when do we sort of decide to back down? Right? And so you have different signals for, you know, how much pain you want to take and sort of thing. Yep. And some, and this is say that conflicts are never lethal. Right, so, you know, the peaceful giraffe shouldn't go to the zoo and feed, right? In nature, the males will have these fights where they'll whack their heads against each other. And it's thought that actually giraffes' long necks evolved not to get at leaves, but actually to help with being battering rams against other giraffes. So sometimes they'll even kill each other. Great video online of giraffes fighting to the death. No, like concussive force.
So does it kill the one that
is
between
the hitting
two
ball? No, it kills the hitty.
The
hitty. Yes.
Okay.
Right. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
That's
still a thing that might happen.
Actually, that's still probably.
Right. So. Yeah. I look, I'm strong enough. Right. Yeah. And actually, they can kill each other. But again, that doesn't happen often because, you know, they're selected for, you know, honestly, I'm bigger, I will win, so let's start. Okay? with symbiosis, you see game theory a lot. Okay? So, for example, fig wasps and figs. So, what we, this is one of our apical taxa, right? So what do fig wasps do? Think of the name. Pollinate. Pollinate fig trees. How do they pollinate fig trees? You know? So most flowers have the flowers on the outside, right? Figs have flowers on the inside. So how do I get pollen from this fig to this fig? I'm cuter than the animals.
You could lay an egg in there, and then as the egg develops, it becomes a mature wasp, and then it moves around, touches all the pollen, and then it goes to another fig, to like its egg, and maybe has pollen on it, so the fig develops, and that's how the pollen spreads.
Yep. Now we have an egg, comes here, goes into a wasp, flies, leaves with pollen, goes here, and draws pollen there, right? Is there any sort of incentive for the wasp to carry pollen? There's a lot of pollination, I mean, like orchids, right? A bee comes, visits an orchid, it sticks on a plinium on top, right? So he's not like choosing to get and distribute pollen, sort of has this big thing stuck to its head or its abdomen or something like that, right? With fig wasps, is there a selective advantage for the fig wasp in dispersing pollen? What is this thing that happens from the egg eating? The fig seeds, actually. Okay. So, how do the seeds, what makes seeds grow? Sunshine. Right, so the pollen causes, you know, fertilization and the embryo develops into a seed. So the fig wasp brings no pollen in, seed won't develop. Right? So for game theory, the fig wasp, you know, those that distribute more pollen probably do better. Right? Okay. Why doesn't the fig wasp then just produce enough eggs to eat all the seeds? It'd be awesome having more kids, right? Greater fitness. Always snitch on the figs. So it could be a long-term strategy, right? Fig wasps evolved that ability. Their figs went extinct, and so did they, right? Which takes a long time to act, so probably not, but possibly. Yep. What else? But, you know, there's lots of figs, lots of fig wasps pollinating, ovipositing here, right? And so you might want to take care of our home. I just want to have lots of babies, right? And so if I could, you know, produce many more offspring than you do, well, you're helping the fig, I'm helping me. Right? So this is where our game theory, you know, why would that happen? And that actually happens. So
yeah.
These also often have short ovipositors, but there are other fig wasps that have these crazy ovipositors, and they can go inside the fig from the outside, so they can carry pollen and then still ovipositing. Yeah. It's actually because figs have this selective dropping of figs. So if a fig has too much parasitism of the seeds, the fig will just drop the seed. Drop the fig entirely. Okay. And so it's a way of enforcing, you know, this anti-snitching behavior, basically. Right? Snitches get dropped on the ground. and so, you know, it changes the selective, the fitness costs for the fig wasp. If you do pollinate, if you do ovipositing too much and have too many offspring killing the fig, you have zero reproductive output because the fig will drop you. Right? So it changes the incentives that way. Yeah?
When you say incentive, though, it's not like the wasp making a conscious decision like to ovipositing less. It's just like a balance between the fig dropping and the wasp.
Right. But the cool thing about game theory is, you know, if the fig wasp were like a brilliant tactician, and a tactician, right? And it's okay, and drew tables and figured out exactly optimal strategy, or just, you know, die less often than other ones, it's the same strategy, right? And so with game theory, oftentimes it's based on, you know, if you get knowing what you know about your opponent, what would you do? Evolution selects the same strategy, right? yeah. In economics, there's a lot of discussion about, you know, information asymmetry, things like that, where if I know the housing stocks are too much, but you don't know that, I can just create a different, you know, mortgage rate than you would choose optimally, right? But in nature, we assume sort of things often don't act with lots of information. We have short sort of information to use. Other areas where game theory come to play? No, just in general. Okay, how so?
It's harder to digest movement, so the plants decided to evolve within processes and other organisms a long time that need them.
Mm-hmm. So possibly, so where you have this advantageous trait of lignin. The one thing that makes it sort of not quite game theory is game theory is based on, you know, you have your opponent doing a different strategy, and you know it's based on what's often given no opponent strategies, which I suppose it could be considered. If you knew the like lignin specialist who would come and eat you, then maybe so. But game theory is often more in like within population variation. But if you extend that to other areas, yeah. Reproduction can be useful, right? So we used to think birds are monogamous, right? There are a pair of birds in a nest or swans that live monogamy, but they're not, right? And they'll often go up to the neighbor's nest and, you know, and solicit a mating, right? And so why is that optimal, right? And so you think about the cost to the benefit of a male to, you know, devoting effort to taking care of offspring, but the female taking care of offspring versus their certainty in paternity and maternity, right? And so if, you know, I'm only 50% sure that those eggs are mine, I might devote less energy to them and might devote more energy to other eggs or something like that. And so there's, you know, different optima there to be adjusted. Same way we talked about the cuttlefish having two different optima. Yeah?
So that would be like the cubs.
Mm-hmm. Right. And by killing the cubs and the females become receptive and you have more offspring. Right? And so the females with game theory, right at first, it's advantageous for them to protect their cubs. Right? Because, you know, you've invested a lot of energy in your cubs, you know, pregnancy, you know, raising them, and so losing that investment would be bad, right? And so they'll fight to defend their cubs. If the cubs are killed, though, at that point, what's the optimal strategy? Well, the optimal strategy is to have more offspring, and then they would mate, right? And so this weird shift in optimality and optimal depending on the conditions of the game. Other questions about game theory?
So cannibalism? I saw on a documentary, it's a leopard, where cubs killed by a boa constrictor, or it's on a python, and she attacked the python and regurgitated in order to escape.
Mm-hmm.
But then she saw the cub was dead, she was under the energy and she ate
the cub. Right, I mean, it's meat that you could eat.
Yeah.
I mean, there's a prion risk, sort of mad cow disease.
Yeah.
That comes with cannibalism. So these misshaped proteins that can cause other misshaped proteins like them, which is why you know, you shouldn't feed cows to cows because eventually you can get these misformed proteins from this cannibalism. People who do ritual cannibalism get this same sort of thing. Not that I know of.
Yeah.
But I mean, you might not be done right away, right? So maybe I might die next year, but this year I have enough food to survive and have offspring. So yeah, sort of. Yeah. But then also the sort of hiddenness of cannibalism. But other than that, yeah. This with cows, the brain tissue is the one that has the prions in it, but I'm not sure if that's a general thing across nature or not.
Okay.
Yeah. Some sharks actually have cannibalism in the womb. They seem to be okay. Yeah. Other questions? All right, I'll see you on Wednesday. And good luck with the midterm if you have questions.